morning. I'm Bruce Hamilton. State officials are releasing a list of 20 additional grain products found to be tainted with EDB, a cancer-causing pesticide. Of course, EDB has contaminated a number of water wells throughout Central Florida, and testing continues. Now, according to agriculture officials, the companies marketing the contaminated products are Old Time Foods Incorporated, R.H. Hammond, and Martha White Foods. The products will be removed from the shelf. The husband of a woman killed when the roof of a furniture store collapsed last July will receive a $150,000 settlement. The roof collapsed on the Aaron Sells Furniture Store building during a rainstorm. The settlement calls for Aaron Sells, the building owners, and their insurance companies to pay the settlement to the Reverend Isaac Mobley. His wife was killed on July 4th. The USS New Jersey opened its guns on Syrian positions for the second time today. In the meantime, the worst fighting in 10 days in Tripoli, Lebanon, was capped by Israeli shelling of PLO chief Yasser Arafat's positions. The bombardment comes as Greece announces its ships will be escorted by U.S. and French warships when they evacuate Arafat's forces next week. Washington denies that that has been set up. Also in Beirut, U.S. Marine guards opened fire on an American television news crew when the crew's car, driven by a Lebanese, approached the wrong gate at the Marine base at the airport. Marines opened fire on the car when the driver failed to stop when they yelled halt. One of the bullets ricocheted inside, slightly wounding the driver. Newsman Joe Corcoran was hit in the shoulder by a piece of metal. He's in good condition.
The whole thing only lasted about 10 seconds, but you live an hour in that 10 seconds. You have so many thoughts. My first thought was just to establish that I was on their side.
Bob Perry is the news director at the North Carolina TV station where the crew is from, and he had this to say.
They were justified in doing what they did. The Lebanese driver apparently didn't know what he was doing. When he was ordered to halt, he didn't.
About 3,000 Christians trapped in the Lebanese mountains in September began a freedom trip today. They were all but held captive by Druze militiamen who had blockaded the town of Deir al-Kamar. The Druze agreed to lift their siege to allow the people and Christian fighters who had flocked there to spend Christmas and New Year's with their families. A Central Florida father gave his daughter the gift of life this Christmas. Fred Horn donated a kidney so his daughter could get off of dialysis. Carolyn Levinson received the donor kidney in an operation today. Hospital spokesmen tell NewsCenter 2 the operation went well, and both father and daughter are doing fine. Now, if all continues to go well, they could go home by Christmas Eve. Imagine the desperation a mother feels when her child simply cannot tolerate any food, an infant. The infant's sick and losing weight, and the child's only hope for survival is feeding on breast milk. But the mother can't produce or has an illness that affects her milk. NewsCenter 2's Andrea Shea reports that's a problem one Central Florida family faces.
When this Eastern Airlines jet arrived in Melbourne, it was bringing with it a gift of life. Nearly 500 ounces of human mother's milk for a Palm Bay child who, without it, might die of malnutrition. Now a year old, at birth, April Hughes weighed only 4.5 pounds. She thrived on her mother's breast milk, but when Rita Hughes weaned her to solid foods, problems began. Unable to handle the nourishment, and with Rita's milk drying up, April began deteriorating. Within weeks, the baby became emaciated. Rita frantically tried everything she could think of, different formulas, baby foods, table foods, but no response. April's condition worsened. After projectile vomiting, diarrhea, and a convulsive seizure, Rita and Bob Hughes knew their baby was dying. Their only hope for saving April was breast milk.
She was like laying on the floor, no energy, no life to her at all. We lifted her arm or something and just flopped. Her leg just flopped, you know, and we really didn't know if she was going to pull through the night. We gave her the 1.5 ounces of breast milk, and she turned over, she sat up, and that was, you know, when I knew, because it stayed in her, and anything else would have just fallen right out of her. You know, so that was the clue that told us that this is what she needs.
But local supplies were severely limited, and April's critical condition meant she'd need hundreds more ounces of the precious milk. From where would it come? Pleas were made through the local newspaper and the Christian radio broadcast network. A milk bank in Kansas heard of her plight, and together with private and commercial airlines, began shipping the milk to the Palm Bay family. Rita Hughes says the volunteer efforts of these heroic people have saved her baby's life, and adds that a similar mother's milk bank is desperately needed for Central Florida babies. If your baby needs this life-giving milk, you can get help. Call 913-676-2108.
Mother's milk is the easiest to digest. First of all, it's made for the baby.
I'm Andrea Shea, NewsCenter 2 in Palm Bay.
A whale of an anniversary still to come on NewsCenter 2 at 11. Some Central Floridians are up in arms tonight because they say Seminole County is ignoring their desire for progress. NewsCenter 2's Leslie Draper reports that people say Seminole County just isn't doing enough for them.
So let's talk about what we need, not what you want to give us.
The county wants to give Roseland Park and Johnson Hill residents more than $750,000 worth of block grant money for community development. Money to be spent on long-awaited modernization of neglected neighborhoods.
What we're doing is taking the ponding out of in front of the streets and near the septic systems, putting it into the street in a closed drainage system and taking it away from the community in this case.
But in a heated discussion tonight at a public hearing in Sanford, community leaders said they need even more money. Money to upgrade dirt roads and homes without plumbing. They've cited instances of outhouses, human waste and garbage in backed up stormwater, and stagnant streams. All violations of existing health codes.
Why have none of these regulations been enforced up until this present time when we have started talking about people with outdoor toilets? You have to owe something to the people for some of the money that they pay.
So as Jackson fights what he calls an urban government in Seminole County, the task force is proceeding with the application for available block grant funds for the rural communities. But at the same time, community leaders are also looking down other avenues for funding and encouraging more citizen involvement. Leslie Draper, NewsCenter 2, Sanford.
Winter Park residents want to preserve and maintain the quaint atmosphere of their neighborhoods. And if that means taking a bumpy ride on brick roads, then so be it. Residents are asking city officials to strip asphalt from what were originally brick roads, and they're making progress turning the tables on what some thought was progress back in the first place.
Well, we didn't like it at all, and now we're going to be happy to see the brick back again. It makes it look very quaint and nice in Winter Park. It's the way it should be.
It's giving the okay to strip Dallas Avenue as a test case and then see how that works out. Well, SeaWorld is celebrating its 10th anniversary today. NewsCenter 2's Sam Dick has more on the growth of Shamu's home since 1973.
What Mickey Mouse is to Disney, Shamu is to SeaWorld, symbol of what Time magazine once called the best-stocked aquarium in the country. It's actually a 125-acre park that attracts nearly 3 million people a year and expects to make $51 million in 1983. That's four times the profit in 73-74. The Arab oil embargo and a recession almost finished SeaWorld before it got started.
We were a small company at that time, and we had a lot riding on the Florida park. We spent about $20 million, so we had to hold back a little bit and decide how much more we wanted to grow. But as 75 came around and so forth, we just continued to grow and grow, and we're spending money all the time now.
Making a decision to stay away from amusement rides, SeaWorld pumped tens of millions of dollars into showcasing marine life. Those shows brought in more than 25 million people and helped support laboratories and animal research centers.
Well, the daily research is just to give us a better handle on how to handle that or treat that animal later on. And each one of these animals are individuals, both in their personality and in their biology.
Today, SeaWorld is expanding in other directions. A $15 million whale arena will open next summer, and a 780-room hotel is being built. It's all aimed at keeping SeaWorld and Shamu on top. Shamu, have you enjoyed this birthday party? Are you hungry? Smart whale. And if SeaWorld stays on a smart business course, park management expects the next 10 years to be even more profitable. Sam Dick, NewsCenter 2 at SeaWorld.
The other night here on NewsCenter 2, we told you that some Merritt Island residents were opposed to the idea of a ship repair shop opening for business in their neighborhood. Well, tonight, in this updated report, we find the shop is one step closer to becoming a reality. The Port Canaveral Board of Commissioners is approving a plan to advertise a lease so the company can set up business. Bill Elias in Central Florida's forecast, still to come here on NewsCenter 2. The Space Shuttle Columbia is back home tonight. It was flown in piggyback atop a 747 from Edwards Air Force Base. Now, technicians at KSC are giving the orbiter a very close once-over. They want to see if they can find out what caused a fire to break out in an auxiliary power supply on landing. If they don't find out, it could delay a scheduled launch of the Space Shuttle Challenger in January. And the weather's been kind of iffy and kind of tentative of late. Bill Elias, where do things stand tonight?
Things look very good as far as rain goes. We're not going to get any. And temperatures are going to be a little bit chilly tonight, Bruce, so I hope you've got your extra blankets if that's what you want to keep warm with. Anyway, temperatures will be dipping down into the mid to low 40s over most of Central Florida this evening, and that will be the same rule for the next couple of days. Let's look at our current conditions first off. Pressures are fairly high and mostly steady over the area, right around 13 and 17 to 1800s. Winds calm or from the north, right around 6 miles per hour, 94% relative humidity in Daytona Beach, 76 in Melbourne, and 93% relative humidity in Orlando. High temperatures this afternoon managed to reach the 70-degree mark in Ocala and in Leesburg. Mount Dora's high was only 59 degrees, and the high temperature for Orlando, Melbourne, and Titusville was at 1 o'clock in the morning. Actually, afternoon high temperatures for those areas were only in the low 60s. Low temperatures early this morning, 52 degrees in Daytona Beach, 48 in Deltona was the coolest reading, and 56 in Melbourne. Temperatures right now, it's 54 degrees in Orlando, 47 degrees in Daytona Beach, 59 in Melbourne. Clear skies over the northern portion of the state right now, giving us a good chance to lose a lot of that heat. 39 degrees in Tallahassee is the coolest reading, and 73 in Key West is the warmest reading. Here's our satellite picture from last night. 24 hours ago, it was that stationary front that was causing us a lot of those problems as far as weather goes. Tonight, things look like this. You can see we're beginning to clear up a little bit over the southeast. That's a good sign. But still, some heavier clouds in the southern tip of the state, and they could get some showers later on. Anywhere from Vero Beach southward, you can see some heavy, moist clouds in this particular area. Could be some rain for them later on tonight and for early tomorrow morning. A satellite picture around the rest of the country showing virtually overcast skies over the northern tier of the country. And this area, north of Texas, right here, that's a storm. That could be affecting our weather by Saturday, causing us some showers. And we hope not, but that's the way things look for right now. Here's our weather around the country. You can see high pressure beginning to take over our weather. That's a good sign. But a storm over the northeast sections of New Mexico, causing the first snow of the season over the northern sections of Texas, western Oklahoma, and eastern New Mexico. There is a traveler's advisory in effect for this area. They've had up to 4 inches of snow and gusty winds of up to 60 miles per hour. Another storm over the Great Lakes, causing a winter storm watch for northern Michigan. Also, traveler's advisories for the eastern Dakotas, southern Minnesota, and most of Wisconsin for this particular area. And very cold temperatures. Bismarck, North Dakota, 17 degrees below zero right now. That means they have a wind chill factor of 48 degrees below zero. Warmest temperatures tomorrow will be in the 60s and 70s over the western coast and in the southern tip of Texas. They can expect to see temperatures in the 60s and 70s. A few 60 and 70 degree readings tomorrow in Florida, but the coolest readings will only be warming up into the mid-teens tomorrow over the northern plains, where they don't expect to warm up to any more than 3 degrees in Bismarck, North Dakota by tomorrow. That's not very warm at all. Well, my forecast for tomorrow calls for mostly sunny, drier temperatures, highs only in the low 70s, lows tomorrow night in the mid 50s. Winds will be out of the north at 7 miles per hour. The extended outlook, showers on Saturday. I hate to say it, a little bit cooler also, with high temperatures only in the upper 60s. Sunday looks a little bit better and a little bit warmer. We should expect to see a clearing and high temperatures right around 70, as I said. Monday looks pretty good. High temperatures again on 70. And Tuesday, look for more rain by the middle of next week with high temperatures again only around 70 degrees. So the first part of our weekend doesn't look too terrific as far as sunshine goes. Looks like we get a few showers. But Sunday looks good, and the first part of the week looks good. Cool, crisp, nice weather.
Okay. You know, I know meteorology is not an exact science, and it's hard to predict exactly what's going to happen in the future, Bill, but
it really
is. Any chance for a white Christmas, maybe?
In Orlando?
Yeah. Sure.
You asked me that the other night, and I believe the last time we had snow was in 1977. I was in Tampa at the time, and it caused a lot of chaos, but not for me. I was used to the snow.
That happened before. It could happen again.
I hope so.
Thanks, nice. Bill. Well, just a little tip for you travelers taking trips in Brevard County tomorrow morning. If your route to work or play takes you near State Road 520, you'd better plan another way around. Florida Power and Light is moving a massive electrical transformer over the road between routes 524 and 528, and the highway is not scheduled to be clear till sometime around noon. The transformer might be a spectacular sight for rubbernecks, but a real pain in the neck for drivers, so be sure to stay clear. Well, Bowie Kuhn is asserting his power. He suspended 4 baseball players today for drug abuse for 1 year. Sports is next on News Center 2 at 11. Boy, Kuhn's not long for the baseball world, but boy, did he get in one last punch tonight.
That's right, he did. In fact, he's done it quite a few times. This one definitely the harshest of all. As Bowie Kuhn has made his statement today, he will not tolerate drugs in Major League Baseball. He has suspended Willie Wilson, Willie Akins, Jerry Martin, and Steve Howe for 1 year. Now, as you know, all four have been involved with cocaine. Wilson, Akins, Martin have been prosecuted for the offense in a court of law. On the other hand, Howe has been hospitalized for his dependency on the drug, but he never was prosecuted in court. His attorney's reaction to the penalty.
The commissioner, that is apparently looking at this thing as a major deterrent action, and he apparently is not looking at this problem with this young man as what in fact it is, a substantially and dramatic severe medical problem.
It's not for me to decide whether it was a fair decision. It was the commissioner who had to decide that, and in his mind and in his heart he made the decision that he thought was right, and he thought that it was right for baseball, and we're going to have to go with that.
The only sign of leniency towards Howe by Kuhn was his case review date, 5 months ahead of the other three. Now, Howe could be reinstated within a year. The other three will be reviewed on May 15th of 1984. Today, the final full practice day for the Maryland Terrapins. Tennessee, of course, winning the wings Saturday night in the Citrus Bowl. The Terrapins head coach, Bobby Ross, and I talked a little bit about the problems Tennessee possesses for his team.
Well, I think the main thing with Tennessee is their speed. I think, you know, and their wide receivers and Duncan and McGee and Taylor, those people like that, they can run. You get them the ball and it's dangerous. You know, it's very dangerous. So I think that's my biggest concern. And then the second factor is you know, their running backs. The Jones boy can run. He's got great speed. He's a good north-south runner. So I think it's just generally their speed. Defensively, of course, that's what their defense is noted for, is a great speed. So that's our problem.
Speaking of that Tennessee D, All-America defensive tackle Reggie White today named the SEC Player of the Year. Now, he is extreme demand by the pros, both in the NFL and USFL. A lot of respect for that young man.
Not only is he a great football player, he's a good person, too. So it's good to see that there are college athletes still left around like him.
It makes me feel good because I really work for it. And like I said, God has blessed me. And I know that I'm really looking forward to this week. And after this week over, I think I can think about professional football then.
And while Reggie thinks about Pro Bowl, Miami quarterback Dan Marino is thinking Pro Bowl. Talk about first. Marino becomes the first rookie quarterback to start. Dan Fouts will be the backup. How about that? Young Dan Marino has come a long way in a short period of time. He, of course, is starting quarterback for the AFC on January 29th. Jack Nicklaus and Johnny Miller had themselves a one-shot lead at the PGA Team Invitational in Boca Raton. Two Orlando pros, David Peoples and Gary Hallberg, are tied for third, two strokes back. Nice to see Peeps doing well. His brother Ron, of course, photographer here at WESH TV. Now for a little round ball NBA style. Kicks. Knicks against the Bulls in Madison Square Garden tonight. The Bulls in red. Watch the move here by Orlando Woolridge. Power move right there inside. And then it was Mitchell Wiggins working at Dave Corzine. Watch this. Corzine to Woolridge. Another power hoop by Orlando. Bernard King had a great night for New York. The fadeaway jumper here, Hamilton can do that. 36 points on the night for King. Bill Cartwright here with the block of the night. This triggers the best sequence of the game right here. Watch the move. Behind the back, Ray Williams, 26 points for Ray. Dave Corzine, though, comes up with the crucial steal. There it is. He feeds ahead to Woolridge, and we'll have the double pump slam. Chicago going on to beat New York 113-107. A couple other finals in college basketball as I have it. Number 17, Michigan State over Brooklyn College, 85-77. And fourth-ranked DePaul beat Alabama earlier today in Japan, 77-76. That'll do it for 11. We'll see you tomorrow at 6.
I put Elias on the spot, so why not you? Yes. Any prediction for the Citrus Bowl? Tennessee, Maryland, even match?
I like Maryland. I think Maryland is the strongest 8-3 team in the country. They, of course, had Willie Joyner was hurt at the time. They lost two of those games. So I really think Maryland is a very big power in college football today. I think they've got a good shot at it.
Okay, Tom. Thanks a lot. News Center 2 at 11 continues in a moment.
Nothing is worse than carrying around dirty, wrinkled, faded, torn, old, ugly money. Well, maybe not carrying around any money, but at any rate, Uncle Sam is trying to get all that dirty money out of circulation. It's using machinery to weed out the tired old bills and hopefully make all of our money crisp, if not plentiful, and mine is certainly not plentiful. You're up to date. Have a good night tonight and a better day tomorrow. We'll be right back.
NewsCenter 2 fashions provided by Jacobson's, Winter Park, and Longwood.